How can we reduce the amount of errors in software development before dynamic testing? One division of testing types, static testing and dynamic testing. Dynamic testing requires the software to be executable or runnable, meaning that the code must be in a state where it can be actively executed to observe its behavior. This is because dynamic testing involves running the software to check for issues like runtime errors, performance bottlenecks, and other behaviors that can only be observed when the code is actively functioning. As a result, dynamic testing can only be performed at a later stage in the project, typically after the initial phases of development, such as design and coding, are complete. During these earlier stages, the software exists only as code, models, or specifications, which cannot be run. It's only once the code has been written, integrated, and compiled into an executable form that dynamic testing can take place. This means that dynamic testing is often conducted during phases like integration testing, system testing, and user acceptance testing, where the software is already built and needs to be validated for correctness, performance, and reliability under real or simulated conditions. Dynamic testing is crucial because it allows developers to identify issues that are not apparent through static testing methods such as code reviews or static analysis, which do not involve executing the code. Static testing does not require the software to be runnable, which means that it involves examining the software's artifacts, such as requirements, design documents, and source code, without actually executing the code. This is a key characteristic that differentiates static testing from dynamic testing. Because static testing doesn't depend on the software being in a working executable state, it can be initiated much earlier in the development process. In fact, static testing can begin before any code has been written. For instance, during the requirements and design phases, static testing can involve reviewing documents and models to ensure that they correctly represent the desired functionality, are logically sound, and meet the project's objectives. Even after the coding phase begins, static testing can continue through methods like code reviews, walkthroughs, and static code analysis. These techniques allow developers and testers to identify potential issues, such as syntax errors, logical flaws, security vulnerabilities, or non-compliance with coding standards, before the software is actually run. By catching these issues early, static testing can help prevent defects from being introduced into the code base, ultimately reducing the cost and effort required to fix them later in the development cycle. Furthermore, because static testing can be performed in parallel with other activities, it provides valuable feedback early in the project, allowing teams to address potential problems before they escalate. This early detection and correction of issues can significantly improve the overall quality of the software and help ensure that the final product meets the required standards and expectations. As stated in a previous video, testing starts with verification of requirements. As soon as the requirements have a certain degree of maturity, we can start with the validation. This will serve then as a supporting activity for the definition of the requirements. And as soon as the requirements are signed off and officially fixed, we can start for real. As discussed in the verification versus validation video, this will be the real start of the verification testing process. The requirements definition phase is where 70% of all errors find their origin. So the challenge here is, how can we catch these errors before they are programmed into the software? Achieving this is very cost-effective as we avoid double programming and testing. We catch the errors before they are built and have become part of the software. We prevent them from happening. Thus, we avoid double programming, double developer tests, and double verification tests. And yes, we will save time and cost, not to mention frustration with the testers due to bad software. Now, let us have a look at how requirements are written. The definition of requirements usually happens in a dialogue between expert users and business analysts. The business analyst tries to extract, identify, and document the requirements the user has. These requirements will make up the content of the software to support the user in his daily business. Experience, however, has shown that these requirement descriptions are often flawed. Requirements need to live up to the following characteristics which are described in software engineering standards. They need to be correct, complete, unambiguous, consistent, ranked for importance or stability, verifiable, modifiable, and traceable. Now, how do we do it? Catching the design errors. We will discuss this now. It is once again a dialogue where we need the subject matter expert to be involved. Preferably, we will involve another SME than the one who has contributed to writing the requirements. There are two reasons for this. The first reason is simple. He will not see his own omissions. This is obvious. Have you ever tried reading through a letter or an article you wrote to see whether it was clear? How successful were you in finding flaws in your thinking, phrasing, or spelling? Probably not very much. I'm speaking of my own experience here as well. The reason is that we often use implicit knowledge in such descriptions that are not known to the recipient or writer of the document. This knowledge is often omitted in the description of the requirements. The second reason is that an SME will not know all the details of the process he was asked to describe. Maybe his knowledge is not up to date, maybe his description is not correct, or it is ambiguous. For this, we need to cross-check these requirements with an SME supported by a good test analyst. A good test analyst has a specific quality. He has a positive negativity in his points of view. What do I mean by that? He will always ask things like, well, what if we turn left instead of straight on as described? Or does this condition always occur? He will think in equivalence classes, challenging that all situations have been covered. A simple example, a solution requires a customer to be of adult age. Questions that will come up will be like, what happens if the customer is of minor age? What is the actual adult age in the country involved? What if a customer is retired? At what age is he retired in the specific country? This is a simple example where conditions can be missed during the initial analysis of the requirements. Now imagine all the conditions, checks, lines, and actions that you would need to program into the software afterward once these simple things were missed. The project delay is obvious. New analysis, additional unit, and integration testing system test is delayed as the system was incomplete and so on. Now, catching these flaws will save time and cost. The degree of cost in finding an error in the next phase is tenfold the cost of finding it in the present phase. Now let us look at the remaining 30% of errors that occur in the realization phase. This means during programming, we need to establish quality control guidelines and activities actively. Of course, there will be, or should be, programming standards that deliver a clean program. Here, it would be best if you thought of principles like modular programming, having sufficient comment lines between the executable lines to explain what that part of the program is trying to achieve, naming conventions for variables so they are recognizable, and so on. These are activities that should be established and practiced within the development department. This clean programming will make the program more understandable for other programmers. These principles can be safeguarded by code inspection within development. Subsequently, maintaining and extending the program will become easier and less prone to errors. Just imagine the original programmer is no longer available, as he has left the company or is retired. You have got a serious problem now. The next step will be to actively involve the testing department together with subject matter experts from the business side. Here we are talking about walkthroughs of the code. This means that we walk through the code as if it were executed on the computer. Here we need the SME and test analyst to support see whether all the relevant paths have been touched once the execution of the software is simulated. Here we will execute on paper, walking through the code and the paths that we later repeat in the black box testing phase on the living object, on the program. The result will be catching at least several realization errors before we enter the black box testing phase. The result is that we will have fewer errors in the black box testing phase. We will have fewer errors to repair and less retesting to be done. This implies that the black box testing phase with its various aspects such as system and integration testing will be shorter. Also, we will save costs as there will be less repetition of testing activities. Finally, we will have a look at the organizational changes that need to be made to enable these activities. First, testing will need to be involved earlier in the software development process as an equal partner. Often this will require an emancipation of testing and quality assurance. Both disciplines must no longer be seen as costly and disturbing the development process. They must not be seen as the evil stepmother or stepchild, however you want to call it. The second condition is that members of the test and QA team are well-trained, coached, and educated in what their activities mean for the project and the company. Also, they need to be appreciated. They are, after all, the keeper of the grail, so to speak. Too often, people in the testing department are the rejects of other departments and are undervalued and not treated with enough respect. Often, this will require a transition process within the company. For further information, contact one of our consultants at NUCIDA Group to discuss your present situation, your problems, and your challenges. Together, we can define a process that fits your environment, will lift limitations, and will lead you to better quality software. Next to the better software, you will experience savings in time and cost, and you will get happier employees, which is itself priceless.